I'm Judy Lampe, and welcome to Low Country Snapshots. Today, we're going to take a look at how some families survived the Great Depression. The United States' Great Depression lasted from 1929 to 1939. It started with the stock market crash in October of 1929. By 1933, unemployment was at 25%, and more than 5,000 banks had gone out of business. Franklin Roosevelt took office as President of the United States in 1933 and began to develop New Deal programs designed to help restore prosperity to Americans. One of those New Deal programs was called Dice Colony, named after William Reynolds Dice, who was director of the Arkansas Emergency Relief Administration. Dice originally wanted to establish 800 families in a self-supporting agricultural community. In March of 1934, William Dice purchased 15,144 acres of unimproved land, which consisted primarily of swamp and cut-over forest land containing deep topsoil deposited by the Mississippi River. Part of this land was at the time in the most productive cotton farming county in the entire United States. The project scope was immediately scaled back to 500 families, with originally 20-acre parcels for each family. Thousands of applicants were carefully screened from Arkansas sharecroppers and tenant farmers from across the entire state. The first buildings at Dice Colony were for the workers and consisted of barracks, a kitchen, and a dining hall. They built a town center, and by the summer of 1934, house construction began for the 500 families. Homes were of simple 4 to 5 room designs to meet the demands of farm living. Each house had a well and was wired for electricity. Each farm had a barn and a chicken coop. In March of 1935, Johnny Cash moved into the colony with his parents and 5 siblings. Johnny Cash lived in Dice until he graduated from high school in 1950. His music was greatly influenced by his experiences in Dice Colony, including Pickin' Time and 5 Feet High and Rising. Cotton grew very well by the Mississippi River, but when the river flooded, it caused many problems. Another resident of this Depression-era Dice Colony was Jim McVeigh and his parents and 5 siblings. Jim is with us today to share his story of growing up during those troubling times in Dice Colony, Arkansas. Jim, how did your family get involved with Dice Colony?
Well, they were sharecropping a small farm in near Dardanelle, Arkansas. And of course, during the 93-94, it was very poor. It was sharecropping. And they had heard about the program that Roosevelt had put forward for all the destitute families in the hill countries that were sharecroppers. And so consequently, they put in the application to become involved in Dice and to move to Dice. And I think some qualifications were that you had to be married, you had to have at least 2 children, and you had to have a farming background. And then, of course, from what I understand, there were like 3,000 or 4,000 applications. So only 500 were selected, as I understand it. So,
how did your father get the land ready for planting crops?
Well, the land was actually all timberland that it was the what they call bottom land that was created when from the Mississippi Delta, when they had used TVA had done some damming on some of the rivers and diverted the flow of the rivers. It was very rich soil, and the county of Mississippi County, where Dice was located, was said to be one of the richest cotton fertile grounds in the state. So consequently, but they had to go in and clear it because it was all brush and forest and all of that. So, and they didn't come in with you're used to seeing now with the caterpillars and all of that. They used mules, saws, hand saws, and that type of thing. they would pull the stumps out of the ground and stack them and later burn them. And of course, that's the way they cleared all the land in a rush.
So what crops did you grow?
Well, we grew corn, alfalfa, and cotton. Cotton being the only cash crop. And then, of course, the corn was basically to feed the livestock, and the alfalfa was also for feed for the livestock. So the only cash crop was actually a cotton crop.
Did you grow any other vegetables?
Oh, yes. Mom had a garden. Maybe it was like a half acre. And I don't know what she planted when she planted her tomatoes, because every 2 days we were picking 2 bushels of tomatoes out of our garden. And she would, of course, take those and can them. And that would be put up for the winter, because, of course, during the winter time there was not any growth or anything. But she raised all kinds of legumes, peas, carrots, black-eyed peas, you name it. She had it in her garden. And, of course, we ate a lot of vegetable soup and that kind of thing. But she canned. She would have maybe 100 jars canned for the winter coming up. So we raised all of our own food.
So what about animals? What animals did you have?
Well, animals, we had to have the horsepower, if you will. They were actually mules. And we had a team of mules, and then, of course, one milk cow to supply the milk, and several swine, pigs, and of course chickens for the eggs, and chickens were one of our main staples for meat. You know, we ate a lot of chicken. And funny story with that, Mom, in order to get chickens every year, we'd order them from Sears Roebuck. You'd order 100 little chicks. They would come, of course, by mail carrier. And out of the 100, maybe there would be 10 or 12 that wouldn't make it. So, and then in 3 months, they were grown, well, big enough that we were using them for food. And of course, the hens, they would go ahead and raise the hens for the eggs.
I understand that they had to increase the acreage from 20 to 40 acres.
Correct, yeah.
So many acres did you have?
Well, it wasn't long until after they settled the community that 20 acres, they realized, was not enough to sustain a family. So they had some type of lottery, I'm not sure, but it seems like it was every other home they would displace the families and tear down the buildings, and then, of course, then every farm would then have 40 acres.
And what were your chores on the farm?
My chores? I would do the eggs. I would do the slopping the hogs. That's what we called it, slopping. And make sure that the mules had their feed, their hay, and their corn, and that type of thing. But all of our chores were mainly in the fields. I mean, we were chopping cotton or picking cotton or planting cotton or doing those things. So the chores were a simple little thing compared to the rest of the backbreaking work. So
what was it like for you to pick cotton?
Well, to pick cotton, it was if no one has ever picked cotton before, it's nothing but manual labor. You would take if you were old enough or big enough, you could fill a 9-foot sack, then you would put that and drag it along behind you, and then you would pick the cotton as you go along. And you'd either be bending over or crawling on your knees in order to do so. And after the sack was full, you'd weigh it and then dump it in the wagon and go back and continue, you know. And usually the hours, it was easy to tell. You didn't need watches, because it would be from sun up to sun down. So, you know, so you didn't have to have time. And picking cotton, my mom always tells a story that I had just graduated from high school. And of course, like I say, backbreaking work. I mean, in the fall, after the frost, the cotton wouldn't mature anymore. So we would have what we'd call bowlies. Anything in the cotton bowl that hasn't opened, then it would still be sellable. You know, it would still have some value. And you would pick that when it was cold in November, December. And I remember I told my mom that after one of those days, it was like 30 degrees and you're out in the, it wasn't hard to drag your sack behind you because most of it was ice. So it was slight. But anyway, I told my mom, I said, you look around and see me. I said, this is the last time you'll ever see me in a cotton field.
What was your own special currency?
Well, our currency actually was really the American currency, except for the supplies. And again, because of the you only had a cash crop in the fall, in order to subsist through the year, they would issue chits called doodlem, and you would go to the administration office, which was in town center. And they would issue you your doodlums for the month, and then you would spend those doodlums at the if you will, the company store, and they would accept those and to buy your flour and your sugar and the stuff that you couldn't raise on the farm.
What kind of movies did you see in the town center?
Well, the movies you'd go to the movies. It would cost you a dime for the ticket, and a nickel for the popcorn, and then we would see Roy Rogers, Gene Autry, Cisco Kid, Lash LaRue, and that type of thing. And then, of course, to get you to come back next Saturday, they would run a serial. And, of course, every week it would be another chapter of that, just like television is today. You know, next week you'll see the rest of the story, you know. So
what else was in town center?
Well, we had just about everything that you needed to sustain yourself. We had the pop shop for entertainment for the kids, and with the jukebox and place to hang out on Saturday nights. And service stations. We had two or three other service stations: a barber shop, drugstore, pharmacy, and the thing to keep the boys out of trouble: a pool hall. The company store, or the general store, we call it, administration store, and the administration building. And it was built in a circle, so all of those buildings were built around that circle. So we used to call it center all the time because it was the center of the community. So
you told me that your house burned down.
Yes, that was back in 1944. I was probably 7 years old, 8 years old maybe. And we cooked with kerosene, and Dad would always get up in the mornings and put his pot of coffee on and light the stove and go out and do the chores, milk the cows and et cetera. Well, consequently, with the tank of the kerosene behind the stove, somehow or other it spilled and started burning up the walls. And we finally just heard Mom screaming, get out, get out, get out. And we were all still in bed. It was like probably 5 o'clock in the morning. And we all, of course, thank goodness we all got out safely. But my brother Bobby, it's a little story, it's always a joke. He even tied his shoes before he left. He completely dressed, and most of us got out in our pajamas, you know, so anyway.
Did you rebuild the house?
We did. We did have, fortunately, Dad had insurance on the house, so we were able to rebuild it, and we used a local carpenter, and we assisted, of course, in the building.
I understand that Johnny Cash lived in Dice County, and he wrote many songs about his experiences there. Did you know him?
Well, I knew, yeah, we all knew Johnny, and at that time he was called J.R., and he wasn't Johnny Cash until he came back from the service and was playing his guitar over in Memphis. But yes, he and his whole family, we grew up with them or went to school with the siblings and that, yeah. And Johnny was, I remember the first time I heard him sing, he was in one of the assembly halls. And Johnny was singing, and he was singing Old Man River. And then, of course, as most of the kids would, you know, they would hiss and boo and everything else, you know. But he was well known and well liked, and very, very nice guy, you know. So, but he became Johnny Cash after he left Dice. He was JR to everyone else. So
Pickin' Time and 5 Feet High and Rising were two of the songs that he wrote. What do you think they were about?
Well, Pickin' Time, of course, was obviously about picking cotton, and that was in the fall of the year. And then, of course, the 5 Foot High and Rising, that was recorded because of the flood of 1937. And at that time, the flood of 37, we had to be evacuated. And they took all the families by school bus to the train station. And from the train station, they took them to Little Rock, to a camp, until the water receded, because it was waist high to even to a grown up. And my dad tells the story of going down the road with the people on the school bus, and they had a neighbor on each side of the bus to keep them on the road, because walking along with them. And my mom was pregnant with me at the time, so she got off at Brinkley, Arkansas, and that was on the way to Little Rock, and I was born in Brinkley. And 5 days later, then we rejoined the family then in Little Rock. Of course, all the nurses realized who the farm folk were, you know, and so one of the nurses wanted to keep me. They didn't want Mom to take me, and of course, fortunately, she refused. And so on the birth certificate, she listed my name as Hiawatha Brinkley. Hiawatha being high water, and then Brinkley, of course, being the town that I was born in, so, or the town that we were at. And my mom tells a story that years later she had to get that changed off my birth certificate to make it what it is today. So,
why was Johnny Cash called J.R.?
J.R., that was just his initials. It was Johnny Ray. So J.R. was his initials. His dad's name was Ray Cash. And so we had a lot of initials back then, you know, but everybody was called both names. That's the reason when at the beginning I gave you the names, but I never knew my cousin had just one name. He was always Madison Dean or Mary Dale, you know, so, but that's just the way it was back then, so.
Tell us about the tragic accident that Johnny Cash's brother had.
Oh, yes, that was pretty tragic. Ray Cash, his dad, held that against Johnny for years and years, but Johnny was supposed to go to the workshop, wood shop, on a Saturday to help his brother Jack do some work, and Johnny loved to go fishing. So he took his fishing pole and went down to the river and was fishing, and then Jack was alone in the workshop at school. And unfortunately, the bandsaw cut him across the stomach. And he eventually lived for about 5 days, and eventually he passed away. And so for a long time, his dad blamed Johnny for Jack's death, because if Johnny had gone with him to the shop that day, he probably wouldn't have died. And of course, it was, the news swept the community, you know. And the way we found out, we didn't have telephones or anything of that nature, so we would be assigned. One of the children would be assigned to meet the mailman at the mailbox every day in order to get news on how Jack's condition was coming along. So that's one reason why I remember it so vividly, I guess.
What other famous people came from Dice Colony?
Well, if everyone asks me where I'm from, I tell them I'm from Dice. And there's two famous people came from Dice, me and Johnny Cash. But anyway, along with that, Buddy Jewell, who is a country western singer out of Nashville, he was a son of one of the guys I went to school with. And he's made a lot of records. And then Tommy Cash, also Johnny's brother, made a few records. He had a hit song called Six White Horses at one time. His sister even tried to sing and was never promoted properly enough, I guess. And then, of course, Gene Williams, who was a music promoter out of Branson, Missouri. And Jean has done a lot in order to bring back all the memories and to rebuild Dice as it is today. He was working with the Arkansas State University, and he was the one that was behind the raising the money in order to do all the things that they've done with Dice now. So Dice is now a tourist attraction. They have over 5,000 visitors a year going through Dice, and they have rebuilt it to basically the way it was back then. So it's been it's still thriving. Saw a blurb on the internet when they were dedicating the Johnny Cash home, who they've rebuilt and refurbished just the way it was back then, and they were announcing it or having the grand opening, and his house is exactly the way it was then, right down to the rugs on the floor, you know. So they rebuilt it completely.
How did your experiences in Dice County really impact your life?
It was such a small town. You knew everyone, and everyone was, as far as status levels and all of this, everyone was exactly the same, you know. And we were friends with everyone. And I don't think there was a dishonest person in town. And we would always help each other. And if someone needed help or assistance or whatever, everyone would pitch in and do it and that type of thing. We all went to the same school. We all had the same teachers. And we grew up from first grade all the way through 12th grade with the same people, you know. So you really created a bond.
What other stories would you like to tell us about?
I guess the one thing that I could remember, I keep going back to Johnny Cash, everybody knows him. Johnny was working with the at a job after we had laid the crops by, and he was the water boy between two crews that we were clearing land for a drainage. And the forward crew would be cutting all the brush and everything, and then the rear crew would, of course, be stacking it and burning it and that type of, and they needed a water carrier between the two crews. So Johnny was working there. My dad was working also in one of the crews. And Dad came home one day and he says, well, JR did it. What's that? He said, well, he got fired. And so consequently, I must have been maybe 11, 12 years old. And so I begged Dad, I says, if JR Cash isn't there, I can do it. They were paying $5 a day. And I had my eye on a bicycle that my friend had across the road, I should say. And he wanted $10 for his bicycle. So I told Dad I had to buy that bike. Dad says, you can't handle it, son. You just can't handle it. It's too much. Two gallon kegs of water, and you're carrying it a quarter mile between these crews. He says, you can't do it. So he did take me to work, and they put me on, and I lasted a day and a half. And he found me. He tells me I was sitting down bawling between the crews because I couldn't go do it anymore. So anyway, they did pay me the $10. I did get my bike, so that was it. So,
you know, you also mentioned that you go back to Dice for class reunions.
Yes.
What are they like?
They started that, I would say, 35 years ago, and they're still doing it every year, 4th of July, and everyone comes back and says hello and have a big potluck, a picnic, and try to catch up with things.
And thank you very much, Jim, for being my guest on Snapshots. This was certainly a very important story to hear.
I got cotton in the bottom land. It's up and growing, and I got a good stand. My good wife and them kids of mine, gonna get new shoes come picking time. Get new shoes come picking time. Every night when I go to bed, I thank the Lord that my kids are fed. They live on beans 8 days and 9. But I'll get them back come picking time. Get them back come picking time. It's hard to see by the cola light, and I turn it off pretty early at night. A jug of cola cost a dime, but I'll sit up late come picking time. Set up late, come pickin' time.